Welcome back to our laboratory of the endless exploration of Chernobyl technology. So today I want to show you this thing, which is the original Soviet-made tool for wire wrap. It was a very popular technology of assembling the electronics back in the 70s. And this little instrument actually is a part of a very big thing. Those who joined us on our Patreon know that in our secret underground lab we are working on the Retr Computing project, the restoration of one of the very last existing control panels of Soviet mainframe computer YES-1060. Exactly the same computer stands at the former data center of the Duga over the horizon radar, which is located at the depths of the Chernobyl exclusion zone. That one is damaged beyond repair and actually very rusty, but it still provides a good reference. So we managed to find the same panel here in Ukraine, and while in front visually it is really good, a lot of components are missing inside. There is no design documentation existing anymore, so what we are doing is manual tracing of the original schematics and repairing of thousands of wired connections. We do it using original period components, and the connections are being made in original way as well, mostly with wire wrap. There were just 313 machines like this ever produced, so you can imagine the complexity of this work. But this summer you will see it here on our channel in action, and then it will be placed on display in one of the museums here in Kyiv. In the meantime, there are nearly 20 updates already on our Patreon page about this, so join us there to become a part of this unique project. For those who are not familiar with wire wrap technique, just a little bit of theory. So, back in the times when electronics was mostly assembled with hands, and connections often were made using thin wires between components. And to solder all that, if you have hundreds or say even thousands of connections, would be really time consuming. So there was invented a method based on wrapping a single core wire around a component's pin. And if a pin is square in this section, then 7 tight wraps of wire around it will provide you with 28 points of contact. This connection, if made correctly, will hold very well, and moreover it will be pretty resistant to any vibration, especially if you add one more row of insulated wire below. Well, if you have round pins, like say in this RPPM connector, well, you still would need to solder the connection after. Exactly this is the way how the chip-based buttons in our mainframe panel were assembled, and here wire wrap was actually quite crude, because even this was sufficient. But the thing is, you cannot provide proper wire tension with just bare hands, so you would need a special tool. So they used to be mechanical or electric, like this one. It is called MP48, and somewhat it is similar to a low-speed drill. Well, it came to me in an original sealed wooden box, all made in 1991. And inside, a part of the instrument itself, there is a brief manual with some specifications and also safety instructions. The instrument has a replaceable head that consists of the outer tube and a rotating core, which has 2 holes. So the central one is for the target pin or a post, and the side one is actually a long recess for insertion of the wire to be wrapped around. And on this tube there are 2 places for the insulated part of the wire, so once the main part is placed, it makes a turn as well, securing the connection. The instrument requires 36 volts AC for operation, and given it needs specifically AC, not DC, I could find only this power supply from the 90s, I guess it's from some telephone or something like that. Well, it is not powerful as required by the manual, but still the instrument works quite okay using it. So let's try it in action. Well, so in my shed I absolutely accidentally found around 4 kilometers of brand new single core twisted pair wire of type MNV specifically for this very task. It has 0.05 square millimeters in this section, and it will perfectly fit our needs. And our target connector will be one of a type GRPPM, which has 5 millimeter step between the pins. And exactly the connectors of the same type, just with a somewhat greater number of contact pads, were widely used for backplanes of YES mainframes, where you would install these standard elementary circuit boards. So I clean about 1 inch of the insulation away, Well, in fact, how much to clean exactly varies on the task, and you pretty much get used with the practice. Then I insert the wire into the instrument and position the pin inside. Then I press the trigger and hold for a second or two. And let's make one more. Well, as you can see, it is super quick operation, and optionally you can also solder it over, but even without that, it will be already super durable and reliable. So that's what we got. Beautiful. And in the case a correction is needed, it's quite easy to unwrap it, then you can straighten the wire and try again. But in the case of said mainframe assembly process, their number of connections was estimated in hundreds of thousands, so they used special coordinate machines that were moving a target over the designated place, so the technician just had to pick a proper wire and make the connection. The machine operated by a program on a punch tape, so basically computers were helping to make the same computers. Well, normally in addition to this, there were a few more tools used. For example, insulation burner, which allowed to remove one and the same length of insulation quite quick. Then there was a placing instrument that helped to position wires between multiple pins. And finally, there was also a manual unwrapping tool, which you placed over a wrong connection to be removed and then rotated a few times to lose it. But for now, I unfortunately do not have any of those. Okay, let's take a look inside, although I do not expect anything extraordinary here. So the head has a small mechanism that distributes the rotation of the core and moves it also back and forth along the target pin, and then makes the final turn of the outer tube. And inside the instrument itself, there is just a motor of type DPM30, also with some coupling that slows down the rotation to approximately 300 per minute. And also there is a simple diode-based rectifier. So basically, if you just bypass it, it's possible to use also a DC power supply. What is not very good to my mind is that this warning that the tool requires 36 volts is not really visible in this transparent case, while the power plug fits into 220 volts power socket. So I wonder how many of those burned away after being plugged into a wrong voltage. So such a nice little tool that got a brand new life. And in fact, I got a second one just in the case. And I'm considering also finding those missing tools I mentioned before to make our restoration work, let's say, more authentic. And then meanwhile, stay tuned for new episodes. Something interesting is coming. And that's it for today. See you next time.